In this video, we'll go over the basics of auto layout as it pertains to the storyboard designer. It's relatively straightforward to design our application's UI to fit on a specific screen size and a specific orientation. But there are a wide range of iOS devices available with different screen sizes, and users expect to be able to switch between landscape and portrait mode within an application. If this happens to a statically defined UI, at best, the app will look weird. And at worst, some of the controls might not even be visible. There are several things that can affect the layout of your UI at runtime: device resolution, form factor, orientation changes, adding dynamic content, user selectable fonts, and localized content. Apple provides an API that we can use to dynamically lay out our views. This is called Auto Layout. Auto Layout is a constraint-based layout system that allows developers to create an adaptive interface that responds appropriately to changes in form factor and orientation. Here you can see an iPhone in vertical orientation with a very simple layout. When the phone is put into a horizontal orientation and our UI is statically defined, we see that the layout no longer makes good use of the available screen space and some of our UI is no longer visible. Auto Layout allows us to define a UI that's responsive and able to adjust itself to fit different screen sizes and orientations. Instead of assigning fixed values for a view's size and position, Auto Layout organizes views by describing relationships between views and relationships between views and their container. Auto Layout is enabled in the designer by default, but it can be disabled. The iOS Storyboard Designer allows us to visually manage auto layout constraints without writing any code. To turn off auto layout, you need to click on an empty space on the design surface to select the storyboard. Then you're going to check or uncheck the Use Auto Layout checkbox in the property panel. This will affect every screen in that storyboard. Turning off this feature will actually do a few things. It will turn on auto resizing masks. It will also turn off size classes, the checkbox right below it. Your design will either change to an iPhone or iPad design. Size classes are a feature in iOS that extend auto layout to define additional size-based rules, which only apply when the UI is on a specific form factor. For example, only on an iPad or only on an iPhone in portrait. We'll be turning this feature off to reduce complexity, but it's another excellent tool once you're comfortable using auto layout and constraints. At its core, auto layout is all about constraints. Constraints are really just a mathematical formula applied to an attribute of a view to determine its size or position relative to the things around it. For example, we could create a relationship between the left edge of a view and its parent. And we can add constant values to these equations to adjust the spacing and position. For example, if we want to indent the view from the top of the parent. These relationships can be defined between sibling views. Here, we're specifying the top of a view be offset from the bottom of another. And this is already very powerful. If we change the height or vertical position of the first view, our second view will reposition appropriately. And these rules can be more complex. For example, we can set one property to be the same value as another. For example, we can make two buttons the exact same width. Or, as you can see here, we can use a multiplier to set a ratio. In this case, our view's height is half of its parent. Auto Layout will dynamically calculate the size and position of the views in your layout based on the constraints that you place on those views. Constraints can be added programmatically or by using the Xamarin.iOS designer. The designer is typically easier, especially when you're first getting started with constraints, as it visualizes the relationships, making it much easier to see the final position, and it provides feedback in case of errors. The iOS designer has two modes for manipulating elements on the design surface. You toggle between these two modes by single-clicking on a view. The dragging mode lets you adjust the frame of the view. It changes the position and size, as you've likely already done. The constraints mode shows T-bar drag handles on the left, top, right, and bottom of the view, which we can use to add constraints. To use constraint mode, select a handle and drag it somewhere on the design surface. A series of green lines and boxes will appear on the surface telling you what you can constrain. You can drop the handles onto the superview, a sibling, or itself. For example, in this screenshot, we are constraining the top edge of a button to the top of its superview, using the top layout guide to position under the carrier bar. We typically work with three types of constraints. Spacing constraints constrain the sides or edges of our views relative to other views. Sizing constraints are used to constrain the width and height of a view. And finally, we have alignment constraints, which constrain the horizontal or vertical center of a view. The four T-shaped handles on each side of an element define the top, right, bottom, and left edges of the element for a constraint. Drag this handle to the edge of another view, either a sibling or ancestor, in order to create a spacing constraint. The system will then define a constraint to keep a set distance from the other view. Sizing constraints allow you to control a view's width and height by dragging the center eyebar shape on the right and bottom edge of a view. To set these constraints, we have two options. You can either drag the handle to constrain to a neighboring element, or double-click the handle to define a constant size value. The middle square handles both center X and center Y constraints. Dragging the square handle will light up the other elements to offer both vertical and horizontal drop areas. Depending on where we drop the square handle, we'll determine if it creates a horizontal or a vertical centering constraint. The Xamarin iOS Designer provides some additional helpful tools when working with constraints. The Designer toolbar contains two buttons to add and remove constraints. The Add Constraints button will add four constraints to a selected view: a constant width, a constant height, and two edge constraints connected to the parent. This adds enough constraints to fully describe the view size and position. The Remove Constraints button will clear any constraints added to the view and reset it to use the frame for positioning. This is very useful when you need to start over. This leads us to an important concept when working with constraints: fully constrained views. A view is fully constrained when there's enough information to uniquely define the size and position of the view. This typically requires four constraints. There are some views, such as buttons, labels, and switches, that will automatically size to their content. We call this an intrinsic size. For these views, constraints to set the size are optional. So then what happens when our view is not fully constrained? As you can see on the screen, the selected view is drawn in orange, and we call this an ambiguous layout, and it means that there aren't enough constraints to define the size and position. To fix this, you just have to add additional constraints. When placing constraints, you may sometimes notice a dotted rectangle on your view controller. This is simply the storyboard letting you know the runtime location of that control. You can fix this with the Update Frames button on the toolbar. Simply select the control, click the Update Frames button, and your view will snap into position as defined by the constraints.